Jobs today, the dole tomorrow. The men who build Britain ships are in trouble. They live where one man in ten is out of work. Their industry is in crisis, its survival uncertain. For 3 years, their jobs have been in growing jeopardy. Today, they hope they're safe. But are they? Today, the bill to nationalise aircraft and shipbuilding became the law of the land after 3 years of bitter political struggle, which delayed its passage onto the statute book and which leaves British shipbuilding in desperate straits, the question of its survival more uncertain than ever.
If you were going to pour public money into shipbuilding, better to have it on, if it had to be on public account, with public accountability and public ownership. And very substantial sums of public money had been put into shipbuilding, did not done the trick, and that was the basis on which we decided to go for public ownership.
Did you expect to get the nationalisation bill through when you were industry secretary in the first session of Parliament?
It was in the manifesto in February 74. We published the proposals in the summer of 74. It was in the October manifesto, in the October Queen's speech, and the bill was published on the 30th of April, a bit late in the session, but I was charged with carrying through the statement made in the Queen's speech that it would be dealt with in the 1974-75 session.
You intended to try and get it through in that first session?
Well, that was the Cabinet decision, that it would be one of the major measures for the 74-75 session.
A fact which, according to Eric Heffer, was to have a profoundly damaging effect on the bill to nationalise shipbuilding.
I think if we'd have shown real determination on the part of the government to get it through in the first session, and I think all the subsequent problems that we had, all the difficulties that arose, would not have arisen at that stage, and I think we would have actually got it through. And I think a great opportunity was missed.
That's a very naive approach. Anybody who had anything to do with this bill knew that it was going to be the most bitterly opposed bill of the Parliament. You can't get a bill of 55 clauses nationalising five industries, which was probably the most controversial bill of the whole Parliament, through between April and July, through both Houses of Parliament. It was decided that the best way of getting the bill was not to try and run it at the fag end of that session.
The present Minister of State and Shipbuilding said it would be naive to have assumed that the bill could have gone through in the first session, that anyone who thought so simply didn't understand the political realities of getting such a controversial bill onto the statute book.
Well, he wasn't Minister of State at the time, and I don't particularly think it was naive. I think that with a determined effort, I think we could have got the bill at that stage.
So, whoever's right, it was the government which was responsible for the first year's delay. But what of the opposition? Well, it made much noise and promised to fight to the bitter end and so on. But for what? For private enterprise, naturally. And for the shipbuilders? Well, you'd have thought so. But their alliance was uneasy. Not least because the shipbuilders weren't sure where the Tories were trying to take them, or whether they really wanted to go. Did you consider that the Tory party had a good alternative to nationalisation?
As an alternative government, I have no doubt they would have developed a policy for shipbuilding. It's an important industry, and any government must take account of that.
Did you feel that they had a policy?
No. And I'm not going to criticise them for that, because I think any party in opposition under present circumstances is entitled to say, let us look at the situation nearer the time when we come to power.
So was there an alternative to nationalisation? The answer was plain to one prominent shipbuilder at least. Graham Day believes in free enterprise, but in 1975 he chose to leave his job and for half his previous salary accept the offer to run British shipbuilding for the government once it was nationalised.
If there were alternatives to nationalisation, none were proposed that, in my eyes, had any validity. And that is not to ascribe to nationalisation sort of support in ideological terms, but rather support for government involvement. The opposition, in my hearing,
The Tory party,
didn't appear to have a plan, or if they did, it didn't get through to me. The industry obviously made a number of proposals, but I view those largely as a defense against nationalization, which many people in the industry were and are opposed to. The industry, of course, attempted to speak with a single voice, as industries do, but the reality is somewhat different. Certainly in ideological terms, some of the leaders of some of the companies were adamantly opposed to nationalization, but there were others who perhaps found themselves saying, no, no, 1,000 times no, and then sotto voce saying, you know, dear Lord, if it doesn't come soon, I don't know what will become of us.
And in terms of the size of the industry, would they be in the majority?
I think so.
By autumn 1975, the worst predictions had been confirmed. A crippling surplus of ships, major orders cancelled, buyers broke, shipyards bust, the world market shrunk in half, the slump deepening, and Britain was still without plans or policy. And so in November 1975, the bill was introduced once more. Would it be right in shorthand to say that at the point when that bill was introduced, British shipbuilding was heading downhill all the way?
Yes. If we talk about an industry, there are some individual companies which, in my opinion, will and would survive regardless. But that doesn't mean that these individual companies would together form an industry in the sense of being able to supply a full range of products.
And the industry was heading towards collapse.
Yes, the industry overall, in my opinion.
This ominous prospect did not unduly disturb Mr. Christopher Bailey. Mr. Bailey doesn't care for socialism, which would be neither here nor there, say that Mr. Bailey repairs ships, and the bill was to nationalize ship repairers as well as ship builders. Mr. Bailey's business was profitable, and he was damned if the state was to have either it or the symbol of his drive and success, the yacht in which his salesmen traveled Europe in the search for orders.
Well, we had created the most competitive and efficient ship repair yard in the whole of Northern Europe. And this had been created through a lot of hard work by trade union leaders, by our employees, and by management.
We say that the moment the Labour Party put forward a plan to nationalise an industry, we should immediately give in, because it's better to end the uncertainty there and then, and so they should get it at once. But that means that they will just get more industries faster. And the total effect on the country's economy, as we all know, is extremely serious and quite unacceptable to me.
It's better to get the industry later and in a worse state.
It's better not to get it at all.
And but if the reality is that they get it later and in a worse state.
Yes, but you didn't know that at the beginning, government, as it always is on all these issues. Many members of it know that this is a piece of dogma to buy off the left wing, viciously expensive, wholly unnecessary, and would have welcomed the bill falling.
Did you find yourself, in a sense, in cahoots with those in the cabinet whom you felt would be glad to see this bill fail?
There were certainly people in the cabinet who hoped that I would have been able to stop the bill.
Can you say who those are?
No.
A party point? Well, even the government's own man, Mr. Day, was in doubt.
I've never been sure in my own mind what measure of will existed on the part of the government overall. One cannot help but be a recipient, willing or unwilling, of various leaks. And it was worrying that there didn't appear to be a unanimity of commitment. In the early autumn, when it appeared to those of us in the committee who, you know, were committed to trying to make this thing work, that the bill was in danger, we used to have a list of the cabinet, and we would try and judge by externals whether we were of the view that they were for, against, or uncommitted. And by and large, we had difficulties some days in getting a majority for the bill.
Graham was and is a superb expert on shipbuilding, and we were very sorry to lose him from the corporation. His expertise in political analysis was not so great, and I don't think he would claim it was. And if he was counting up the cabinet, he ought to have come to us, because we could have told him that the cabinet was unanimous the whole time.
At this point, it's been suggested that some senior ministers would have been ready to let the bill die, limit nationalisation to those companies already owned by the state, and let the rest fend for themselves, blaming it all the while on the Tories, and of course saving a lot of public money. Suggested, but apparently not so.
We would never have got away with that view even if we'd held it. You can blame things politically on the Tories, but it won't stop the representatives of the workers coming to you and saying, what are you doing to save our jobs?
The autumn of 1976, another year on, the prospect worse than ever. World demand down by 2/3 in 2 years. The yards in their worst crisis since the 30s. Every other nation with plans for the slump, Britain still with none.
The bill, meanwhile, approved by the Commons, had reached the Lords. The end at last. By no means. Instead, a constitutional crisis of the first order. By late 1976, Labour's majority in the Commons had all but disappeared. The Lords knew this and were poised to make their mark. They disapproved of the bill, believing that ship repair should remain in private hands. So they offered the government a deal. Drop ship repair, and we'll let the rest pass in peace, keep it in, and we'll fight to the end.
Were you not, in the words of the industry secretary, Bailey's poodles?
No, certainly not. I admire the way Mr. Bailey fought for the independence of his firm on the Bristol Channel. But we took a decision of principle about the whole ship repairing industry.
Am I right that had there been a greater majority in the Commons in support of the bill, that you would have not sought to challenge it in the Lords?
Speaking for myself, yes. I mean, had there been a Labour government with a substantial majority and had they carried it through by 100 or 50 or some substantial majority, I personally would have felt much more chary of challenging even the minor part of that bill in principle. But where you've got a position in the elected chamber where it is uncertain to the point of almost one or two critical votes, one vote one way or the other, then I think that you can more properly say in the House of Lords, the will of the people expressed to the elected chamber was, to say the least, unclear.
We had a commitment to nationalise ship repair. That commitment was no less than our commitment to nationalise shipbuilding, marine diesel engines and aerospace. That commitment was a commitment not only of the Labour Party, but of the Confederation of Shipbuilding and Engineering Unions, who badly wanted it. It was supported in the lobbies in the House of Commons on every occasion when we put it through. We never lost a single vote on this bill at any stage during all its long history in the House of Commons. Were we really to say to a parliamentary Labour Party, some of whose members had come in sick and risked their lives to vote for ship repair, that we were going to abandon it simply because the House of Lords had decided that it wanted that as a titbit?
So, deadlock, to the despair and amazement of Graham Day.
The thing I couldn't get my own mind over, and still can't, was that if it was generally held, as I believe and hope it is, that the industry is in a such major problem that that should have been the primary consideration. I felt that the ship repairing should have been let go in November.
You weren't given an opportunity to put that view forward to the cabinet, were you?
Oh no. Our function was simply to plan for the industry post vesting. And indeed, we had no dealings with the cabinet. Understandably, we were sort of supernumerary to the Department of Industry. I fear for the survival of the industry as an industry. I think and believe that more jobs will now be lost than would have been lost had the bill carried some 18 months earlier.
Mr. Bailey, of course, has won. But what of his men? His yards, too, are hit by slump. Orders are few, layoffs longer. So who really has won what?
I think we have scored a victory for the small man, and our reason for fighting is quite simply this. If we fail now, we fail because of our own efforts and not because some twit in Whitehall has pulled the wrong string for the wrong reason.
Do you expect those who now face the prospect of longer layoffs, more redundancies, to rejoice with you at your victory?
No, but they will know that we will fight for their jobs as we fought this government, and they know that we will fight to get work to our yards.
But your company is, if I'm right, half the size, though, that it was a few years ago.
Yes.
So you're fighting for their jobs, but in effect losing that fight.
We're not replacing those men who get over 65. We're not taking on apprentices at the moment, and therefore, year by year, our numbers do reduce. It may be that we will have some further redundancies.
And that fear is felt in the yard. Mr. Bailey's most stalwart supporters now believe that their boss could no longer muster the support which helped him win his campaign against the bill.
Would I be right to assume that if you were to take a straw poll now, you would probably get a majority refusing to support Mr. Bailey's stand at the moment in the yard?
At the moment in the yard? I wouldn't like to say. I would say probably you are right.
Now nationalisation is upon us, but 3 years on, the industry it was designed to save is threatened with collapse. Most of the yards have no work beyond the end of the year. To save tens of thousands of jobs, the government must win orders from across the world in a cutthroat market, for the slump is deeper than ever. Nor is uncertainty over. Enemies of the new act predict chaos and promise repeal.
We will very rapidly find that the British Shipbuilding Corporation runs into very large losses. It will be employing far more people than there's a genuine demand for. And the rest of us as taxpayers, and we are all increasingly heavy taxpayers, will find ourselves pumping vast sums of money in order to sustain people in jobs which are not productive as far as this country is concerned. That is what's going to happen.
Do you commit yourself now in a future government to repeal the Nationalisation Act?
We've made it quite clear that, that if these companies come into the hands of the state, as far and as fast as possible, we will offer them back to the free enterprise market.
So, an election could change everything. Uncertainty remains. Uncertainty which, according to the only man who has no axe to grind, has already done irreparable damage.
Years ago, all of the shipyards in the nation had work. If the bill could have become law then, or it was clearly in the cards it would have become law, then one could have devoted the whole of one's energies, and indeed one could have pulled the industry together with their energies, to plan for that time when work wouldn't be available. But the thrust would be saying, there is a problem, it's going to bite tomorrow, but today we can plan. 3 years down the road, which is today, we have still the absence of a plan and no work. So consequently, those who are now responsible for the industry are going to have to, in theory, worry about keeping men employed on the one hand and planning on the other. And I think that's what's virtually the impossible task.
That's very depressing. I mean, it means virtually the end of a serious industry, if you're right.
I hope it's not as depressing as I feel, but I mean, I obviously felt very depressed last November, and nothing I've seen since has lifted the gloom for me.
The government, despite the pointed departure of Mr. Day, still claims to know where it's going, but one might wonder whether it's not in the unhappy position of a doctor trying to treat a dying patient in the dark on a ship which is sinking.
Being realistic and doing as well as you hope to do, how many people do you expect to be employed in the industry in, say, 5 years' time?
I couldn't say. We've not made that kind of plan. We've not made extrapolations of how many jobs we want to get rid of or anything like that. And in addition, there's never been an overall plan for the industry. The major job of the British shipbuilders, the new corporation, will be to work out the first plan for shipbuilding that this country has ever known.
If I were a shipworker listening to you, I'd be a worried man, as the minister.
You'd have every right to be a worried man. The shipbuilding industry in Britain, in common with every shipbuilding industry in the world, including that of Japan, is facing its worst crisis for nearly 50 years.
The future of at least a million men, women and children is in the balance. And who's to blame? Anyone? No one? Has the last 3 years revealed a healthy democracy in action? 3 years ago, the issue was jobs today, dole tomorrow. Now, it's jobs today.
I'll show you if you go in there. I'm